they're a lively group, but they're sweet kids. We're going to do our songs right now.
Yeah.
fighting for the deaf. All right, here you go, girls. A little bit older.
Angels, we are the word of God.
via Jenny, is going to do, I'm gonna take a road trip. I've had enough road trips. I'm staying home for a while. Let's let him go.
Hey, okay. We're gonna need you guys to do a favor for us. We gotta keep it to a hush. Because we may not hear the piano.
Yes. I'm just going to talk to you about
As a child growing up, we did not have a Christmas tree at our house. I do not know why, but Dad just would not allow it. And I never thought very much about it until this year when I was putting up my Christmas tree, and I wondered, why do we put up a tree? What does it mean? Is there a meaning? So I decided to do research. I found some facts, I found some legends, and some folklore. And I just thought it was interesting enough to share. Many folk legends have grown around the Christmas tree. Christ's blessings and gift to mankind in the form of a decorated tree remains the central theme of most. Across Europe, people use tree-based folk tales to teach children about the celebration of Christ's birth. One story tells that when Christianity first came to Northern Europe, three virtues, faith, hope, and charity, were sent from heaven to find a tree as high as hope, as great as love, as sweet as charity, and one that had the sign of the cross on every bough. Their search ended in the forest of the north, where they found the fir tree, lighted with the radiance of the stars. It was the first Christmas tree. Evergreens have been a symbol of rebirth from ancient times. Egyptians brought green palm branches into their homes on the winter solstice as a symbol of life's triumph over death. The Romans decorated with evergreens during Saturnalia, which is a winter festival in honor of their gods of agriculture. In Northern Europe, people observed the solstice festival of Jule, a two-month feast beginning in November, with prickly pine branches hung around doorways and windows to keep away demonic spirits. During the 7th century, a monk from Devonshire spent time there preaching the word of God. Like any good instructor, he used props. The story goes that he used the triangular shape of the fir tree to describe the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit that makes up the Holy Trinity. By the 12th century, the fir tree was being hung upside down from ceilings in Central Europe as a symbol of Christianity at Christmas time. Legend has it that a missionary to the Germans, St. Boniface, in order to stop sacrifices at their sacred Donner Oak tree near Gesmar, chopped the tree down in 725 AD, supposedly with one mighty blow. St. Boniface felled the massive oak, and as the tree split, a beautiful young fir tree sprang from its center. St. Boniface told the people that this lovely evergreen, with its branches pointing to heaven, was indeed a holy tree, the tree of the Christ child, a symbol of his promise to eternal life. He instructed them henceforth to carry the evergreen from the wilderness into their homes and surround it with gifts, symbols of love and kindness. From the 11th century, religious plays called mystery plays, including the popular Paradise play depicting the story of creation of Adam and Eve, their sin, and banishment from Eden. An evergreen tree was a logical choice for a lush garden tree on this winter festival, and it was decorated with apples symbolizing the forbidden fruit. It ended with the promise of the coming Savior and his incarnation. So gradually, wafers, symbolizing the forgiveness of sins in communion, were added to the Paradise tree, making it now not just the tree of knowledge, but also the tree of life. This resulted in a very old European custom of decorating a fir tree in the home with apples and small white wafers, representing the Holy Year of Christ at Christmas time. These wafers were later replaced by little green pieces of pastry cut in the shapes of stars, angels, hearts, flowers, and bells. In some areas, the custom was still to hang the tree upside down. In addition to the Paradise tree, many German Christians set up a Christmas pyramid called a Lichtstock, an open wooden frame with shells for figurines of the Nativity, covered with evergreen branches and decorated with candy, pastry, candles, and a star. The star, of course, was the Star of Bethlehem. The candles represented the light of Christ coming into the world. The evergreens were the symbol of eternal life, and the candy, the fruits, and the pastries, the goodness of our life in Christ, the fruits of the Spirit. By the 17th century, the Lichtstock and the Paradise tree became merged into our modern-day Christmas tree. most children have seen a Christmas tree. And many know that the pretty and pleasant custom of hanging gifts on boughs comes from Germany. But perhaps few have heard or read the story that is told to little German children respecting the origin of this custom. The story is called The Little Stranger and runs thus. In a small cottage on the borders of a forest lived a poor laborer who gained a scanty living by cutting wood. His wife and two children who helped him with his work. The boy's name was Valentine and the girl's name Mary. They were obedient, good children and a great comfort to their parents. One winter evening, this happy little family were quietly sitting around the hearth, the snow and the wind raging outside while they ate their supper of dry bread. When a gentle tap was heard on the window and a childish voice cried from without, "Oh, let me in, pray. I am a poor little child with nothing to eat and no home to go to, and I shall die of cold and hunger unless you let me in." Valentine and Mary jumped from the table and ran to open the door saying, "Come in, poor little child. We have not much to give you, but whatever we have, we will share with you." The stranger child came in, warmed his frozen hands and feet at the fire, and the children gave him the best they had, saying, "You must be tired too, poor child. Lie down on our bed, and we can sleep on the bench for tonight." Then the little stranger child said, "Thank God for all your goodness to me." So they took their little guest into their sleeping room, laid him on the bed, covered him over, and said to each other, "How thankful we ought to be. We have warm rooms and a cozy bed, while this poor child has only heaven for his roof and the cold earth for his sleeping place." When their father and mother went to bed, Mary and Valentine lay quiet contentedly on the bench near the fire, saying, before they fell asleep, "The stranger child will be so happy tonight in his warm bed." These kind children had not slept many hours before Mary awoke and softly whispered to her brother, "Valentine, dear, wake and listen to the sweet music under the window." When Valentine rubbed his eyes and listened, it was sweet music indeed, and sounded like beautiful voices singing to the tones of a harp. "O holy child, we greet thee bringing sweet strains of harp to aid our singing. Thou, holy child, in peace art sleeping, while we our watch without are keeping. Blessed be the house wherein thou liest, happiest on earth to heaven the highest." The children listened, while solemn joy filled her heart. Then they stepped softly to the window to see who might be without. In the east was a streak of rosy dawn, and in its light they saw a group of children standing before the house, clothed in silver garments, holding golden harps in their hands. Amazed at this sight, the children were still gazing out the window when a light tap caused them to turn around. There stood the stranger child before them, clad in a golden dress, with a gleaming radiance around his curling hair. "I am the little Christ child," he said, "who wanders through the world bringing peace and happiness to good children. You took me in and cared for me when you thought me a poor child. Now you shall have my blessings for what you have done." A fir tree grew near the house, and from this he broke a twig, which he planted in the ground, saying, "This twig shall become a tree and shall bring forth fruit year by year for you." No sooner had he done this than he vanished, and with him the little choir of angels. But the fir branch grew and became a Christmas tree, and on its branches hung golden apples and silver nuts every Christmastide. Such is the story told to German children concerning their beautiful Christmas trees. Though we know that the real little Christ child can never be wandering cold and homeless again in our world, inasmuch as he is safe in heaven by the Father's side, yet we may gather from this story the same truth which the Bible plainly tells us, that anyone who helps a Christian child in distress, it will be counted unto him as if he had indeed done it to Christ himself. Inasmuch as you have done unto the least of these my children, you have done unto me. Christmas trees are neither a significant pagan or biblical symbols, but various Christian traditions have evolved that use the evergreen and its decorations to symbolize and teach the wonderful truth of Advent, God sending his Son to bring life eternal to a fallen world. Though abused by popular culture, Christmas trees make a still point to that true light of the world. Woo-hoo!
Emily Sutherland was the next person was going to sing for us tonight, and she's got something wrong with her ears, and she can't even hear her tones and all. So sometimes you get things, girls. I have people crawling on me over here. I do love kids though. So the next people that are going to go is the pastor and Julie, and how many more? We have an awesome, awesome pastor family. I enjoy working with them. I really do. Holly, when she first came here and sang with us, she was 7 years old. And her dad said she's going to sing a song. And she just bellowed out. So we knew from that point on that she was going to be something marvelous. And she does a lot. She goes and is the song leader for the different groups in Marietta, which is the head of our whole district. So she's got a lot of talent. She sing a lot of songs we sing on her. She wrote them. So she's very good at pastor. What can we say? We're on the praise team together. I hear you with me, sir. No, I love it. I love it. I don't know. Let's see. I can't find Jackson. I don't know where she went. Have you got her? Okay, is she going to do her little song? Oh, there she is. My goodness. And I'm not sure. She's changed her mind about 3 times. Let's just wait and see.
How the Christmas story is told. You just know the gist of it, and you love to hear it, and who does it better than Linus on Charlie Brown Christmas? It's always the greatest story ever told. Mighty God and fragile baby, hillside. On hillside ends a shepherd, leaves a blinding light. Angels singing carols in the cold. Eternal revelation.
Glory stream from heaven. is born.
Thank you.
Maybe I've been here before. I know this room and I've walked this floor. I used to live alone before I knew you. I saw your flag on the marble arch. And love is not a victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah.
Celebrating the Christmas holidays, and we love all of you, and so if you want to sing along with this, we hope that you do.
Why doesn't a seagull fly over the bay? Because they'd be called bagels. That's right. Thank you. I did my part. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.